Hello and welcome back to my channel. This is Stolen From Me and I am Lindsay, and as always, my channel come with the same usual listener discretion. Before we jump into this week's episode, please don't forget to subscribe, like and share. Thank you all so much and let's get started. Alesha Sarah Macphail was born in Glasgow on October the 22nd, 2011. Alesha's parents, Robert Macphail and Georgina Loughran, separated when she was just 3 months old. Alesha lived with her mum in Airdrie in North Lanarkshire. I apologise if I'm saying that wrong. But she stayed with her dad every other weekend. Robert lived with his parents in the Isle of Bute in Rossi. Now, the Isle of Bute is a beautiful island close to the beach with a population around 6,500. It's known to be a safe place to live, where you don't have to lock your doors and everybody knows everyone. Perfect to have your summer holidays. Alesha was 6 years old. She was in primary school and she loved her teachers. She was described as happy, smiley, and she loved gymnastics. On the 28th of June 2018, Alesha was going to stay with her dad and grandparents for a couple of weeks just out of the summer holidays. After her ferry trip to meet them, Alesha was so excited to see her grandparents. She was banging on the back of the car seat all the way to their house. Later that evening, she gave her granddad a big hug and told him that she loved him. Alesha had been with her dad and grandparents for a couple of days, and on the 1st of July, Alesha had spent the day out with her family. It was getting close to her bedtime, so she was allowed to stay up just a little bit and watch Peppa Pig in bed, which she absolutely loved. She felt tired from the day as she had been so busy with her family, she just drifted off to sleep. Around 11 p.m, Robert's girlfriend Tony would check in on Alesha. Tony popped her head round the door just to check up on her, make sure she's okay and is asleep and not actually still watching Peppa Pig. Alesha was sound asleep. Like I said, being a safe island to live on, they left the key in the door. The following morning, Callum, Alesha's granddad, got up and ready for work. He'd popped his head around Alesha's door to say hi before he left for work, only to find her bed empty. Callum quickly notified everyone in the house to look for Alesha. She must be somewhere, he thought. She's never done this before. Her bike was still in the garden, but she was nowhere to be seen. Angela, Alesha's grandma, phoned the police and reported her missing at 6:23 a.m. Scanning the area looking to see if they could find Alesha, Angela went to Facebook and created a post and asked for help. Before the family could even think, they already had locals gathering outside to help find Alesha. The police began searching the area and they used helicopters to help, and they also informed the Coast Guard to search for the shorelines, just to see if Alesha was near the beach, as they were just so close to the beach. This was around 7 a.m. The Facebook post was continuously being shared, and a local man, George Williams, happened to be on Facebook at the time and saw the post. George joined in with a search. This was around 8:55. As George was looking around the woodlands, which was formerly a hotel, he came across the body of a naked young girl. Georgina, Alesha's mum, found out about her daughter's disappearance on Facebook through the post that her grandmother made, which I think is unbelievably shocking. It's a terrible way to find out that your daughter's missing. Alesha's mum was 70 miles away and she commented on the post saying, "Anyone tell me what's going on? That's my daughter." Georgina soon made her way to the Isle of Bute. Tony, Robert's girlfriend, then noticed that she had a missed call from some boy on the island called Aaron Campbell. This was at 9:01. She tried to call him back, but he just responded with, "Sorry, it doesn't matter anymore," with a couple of laughing emojis. Tony explained to Aaron that Alesha has gone missing, and he replied, "Oh, damn. I'm sure she's not gone far," with a kiss. The post-mortem was conducted on the 3rd of July. The autopsy concluded that Alicia's cause of death resulted in significant forced pressure to her face and her neck. Alicia had 117 separate injuries to her body. The police launched a murder investigation, and the police believed that the killer was still in the Isle of Bute. Every resource from the police was made available to help with this major investigation. The police would go door to door looking for any information they could find. Several parts of the island were cordoned off for forensic experts searching for evidence. Aaron Campbell, the boy who phoned Tony earlier, his mum Jeanette, would help with the search. She only lived about a 5-minute walk from Alicia's grandparents' home. Everybody on the island was completely devastated by the news. This shook the whole island. Jeanette had CCTV outside her home from when her mother used to stay with her. Her mother had dementia, and this made Jeanette feel just that little bit more safe. As Jeanette was looking for the footage of the CCTV, she noticed something that turned her stomach upside down. Her 16-year-old son Aaron was seen on camera leaving her home around 2 a.m. and then returning home. He did this a couple of times. Jeanette confronted her son about this, and he said that Alicia's disappearance had nothing to do with him, and he had a party that night, that's why he was in and out. His party ended around 12:30 a.m. Aaron was born in Shropshire, but moved with his family to the Isle of Bute when he was 5. Jeanette and her husband Christopher also had a daughter. Aaron was tested for ADHD and had a history of depression and self-harm. As Aaron became a teenager, he was referred to as well-liked at school. He would often drink alcohol and smoke cannabis with his mates, and he liked to party. From the age of 12, he wanted to become a YouTuber, posting content of him chatting and jumping off trampolines. He loved parkouring. He was obsessed with Slender Man, particularly the game. But Aaron had two sides to his personality, a fun party-goer with friends. Then he had a dark side waiting to come out. Aaron was actually offered help and placed into rehab, but instead of taking this as an opportunity for a fresh start, he would actually instead just start fires and that would be it. The reason Aaron wanted to speak to Tony earlier when he called her was he wanted cannabis, but he used to buy cannabis from Robert, Alicia's dad, in 2017. But it's believed that they fell out because Robert sold Aaron some poor quality cannabis. As a result, Robert didn't get paid for his product. In 2017, it's believed that Aaron had a sexual relationship with Robert's girlfriend, Tony. The 30th of June 2019, Aaron had been camping, and then the following day he took to Snapchat, where he sent 15 invites out to attend his party on the 1st of July. That was the night Alicia was murdered. Aaron's party was well underway. He drank about a bottle and a half to 2 bottles of wine. One of Aaron's mates found him upstairs in his bedroom. He was upset, to the point of borderline suicidal, in fact. Aaron was in a state. He said that he'd been arguing with his mum all night. His friend was genuinely concerned for Aaron and asked if he wanted him to stay with him. But Aaron said, no, it's okay. He just wanted to grab some cannabis, get stoned, and that was it. The party ended at 12:30. He then sent out several messages to his mates asking if anyone had any smoke. This is when he tried to call Tony. He didn't want to phone Robert because he still owed him money. But Tony, she didn't pick up because it was actually 1:45 in the morning and she'd probably been in bed after a fun day out with Alicia. Aaron then got it into his head. If he couldn't get hold of anyone for any smoke, then he was just going to go out and steal it himself. So he went downstairs in his mum's home and he went into the kitchen. He then took a kitchen knife out of the drawer. He left his mum's house just around 2 a.m. with the knife. He headed towards Robert's home, which was around a 5-minute walk. He then broke into his house. The first bedroom he came to was Alicia's. Alicia was sleeping soundly. He remember thinking that when he saw her laying there, he had this overwhelming thought that he just needed to kill her. While his mum was convinced that her son had nothing to do with the investigation, she did report to the police that she had CCTV, and she handed over the tapes. And she said that her son was on the tapes, but he didn't have anything to do with the investigation. And she just wanted to make it clear that he was on the tapes, but like she said, it wasn't him that did anything. Aaron was later interviewed by detectives, answering questions with ease. He seemed pretty relaxed, he wasn't worried, and he showed no signs of someone who may have committed the murder. Definitely someone who didn't show any remorse. Aaron told detectives that he'd been out that night, and he only went out to buy some smoke and then he came back. On the 4th of July, Aaron Campbell was arrested on the suspicion of murder. After answering every question with no comment, the police still believed that they had enough to charge Aaron, so they did. Aaron was charged with the murder and rape of Alesha Macphail. Aaron was placed on remand until July the 13th. He didn't enter a plea. But finally, on the 10th of December, he would enter a plea of not guilty. The trial would begin in February. Because he was under the age of 18, he was granted anonymity. No media was allowed to report who was standing trial. As Aaron stood in the court facing Alicia's family with a plea of not guilty, never showing any signs of remorse for what he had been charged for, Aaron even tried to lie and implicate Tony in the murder of Alesha. While Alesha's family and the court heard how Aaron had left his home and broke into the Macphail's family home, he had removed Alesha from her bed, carried her outside, where she was half asleep, half awake. She asked Aaron where she was going, and he told her not to worry and said that he knew her dad. Alesha then said that she was cold, and Aaron gave her his top. He carried her to the wooded area where he inflicted unspeakable acts of sexual violence on this six-year-old girl. Alesha had 117 different injuries to her body. He had raped her, murdered her, and left her. He then grabbed their clothes and dumped them in the sea. The kitchen knife that he had when he left was found on the shore. He returned home, had a shower, and then returned back to Alicia's body where he went to try and find his phone. He then went home again, and this is where he showed up on his mum's CCTV. Aaron underwent numerous mental health assessments and speaking to several different psychologists. All the reports that had been written up all found that Aaron did not suffer from any mental health or syndrome or disorders. All Aaron displayed in court was the complete lack of empathy for the victim and the families. Aaron stated that when he saw Alesha asleep, he saw this was a moment of opportunity. Throughout DNA testing, numerous items of clothing that was recovered from the beach was identified in court by Aaron's own mother. Jeanette said that in court, the clothes found on the beach did in fact belong to her son. Fibres that was found on the trousers that was recovered from the beach, which belonged to Aaron, were also found on Alicia's pyjamas. Forensic scientist Stuart Bailey also testified that the DNA was a perfect match for Aaron, and the clothes that he wore and dumped on the beach matched the DNA found on Alicia's neck, face, and 14 other areas of her body. The probability of the DNA matching anybody else was 1 billion to 1. In court, it was also revealed that Aaron had taken a Snapchat video on his phone of himself, and he sent it to 25 of his friends saying, "Found the guy that did it." The court also heard from a cybercrime expert, and on Aaron's phone, the night of the disappearance of Alesha, he searched on Google, "How do police find DNA?" He then clicked on a webpage called Collecting DNA Evidence. Campbell took to the stand and unbelievably tried to argue with his defence team that Tony, Robert's girlfriend, had been jealous of Alesha and jealous of the relationship she had with her dad. So she was the one that actually killed Alesha. And she actually had sex with Aaron in the garage, where she saved the condom and then she planted it after killing Alesha. Aaron said that after killing Alesha, Tony then put his semen over her body to make it look like he was the one that killed her. This broke Tony's heart. When she heard what he had made up, the media also took the story and ran it in the newspapers. They also named Tony in the newspapers. Now, this was so unfair because actually Aaron's name wasn't even allowed in the newspapers because he had anonymity. So he was ruining her life. However, Alicia's grandma stood up in court and stated that Tony had a loving and kind relationship with Alesha and she would never do anything to hurt her. And what Aaron said is completely untrue. Aaron answered more questions and was completely unfazed by the whole court hearing. Aaron's team even tried to say that there wasn't any way that he could carry Alicia's body from her home to the wooded area, as she weighed 49 pounds. But the doctor actually stated that in an interview with Aaron, he found it highly amusing that the police took 2 days to actually arrest him after Alicia's body was discovered. The pathologist said that Alesha would have been carried as her feet were still clean and she had no scratches or marks to the bottom of her feet. The trial lasted 9 days. The jury took 3 hours to come back with a unanimous verdict of guilty on the 21st of February 2019. Lord Matthews said that Aaron Campbell had committed some of the most evil and wicked crimes that the court had heard in decades. Aaron still didn't show any remorse. The media believed it was unfair that Aaron Campbell's identity would remain hidden, and they made a legal bid to remove the anonymity. The court would grant this, and Aaron Campbell was no longer protected by the courts. This was a first for Scottish history. Lord Matthews also made it very clear in the courts and the media that Tony had no involvement in Alicia's murder, abduction or rape whatsoever. And the media went and printed that as well. After speaking to several doctors, Aaron stated that he was quite satisfied with the murder and told them it took everything out of him not to laugh in court. Aaron's mum, "I was looking to see if there was anything to do with the little girl on the CCTV walking past," she said in court. "But all I saw was my son coming back into the house at around 3 a.m. Before Aaron Campbell was sentenced, he did actually admit kidnapping, raping and murdering little Alesha. The postmortem that Dr. Williams carried out on Alicia's body. Alicia's injuries were so severe that the prosecution said, "Have you ever seen anything like this in your professional career?" Dr. Williams said no. He added that the postmortem showed that Alesha had significant forced pressure to her neck and her face. She had suffered bleeding from her eyes, her mouth, her tongue. She had bruises and scratches and abrasions on her forehead, ears and her neck. This is indicative to the infliction of trauma, i.e. smothering. She suffered forceful movements to her head and neck, consistent to either being shaken on her head or when it was unsupported, or her hair was grabbed and violently shook. Her genitalia sustained catastrophic injuries. Lord Matthews told Aaron he was cold, calculated, remorseless, and he was a danger. He had complete lack of empathy and was shocked that he just didn't care. He sentenced Aaron Campbell to 27 years in prison before he could apply for parole. this is basically life in prison. But because he was under the age of 18, he was forced to do a lesser sentence, which is why he got 27 years. He was told that he may be able to get parole after 27 years, but then again, he may not. In August, Aaron appealed his sentence in the Court of Appeal. The judge reduced his sentence to 24 years, removing 3 years off his sentence. This was in light of his age. However, a psychologist called Dr. Gary McPherson concluded that I am of the view of the capacity for change may be limited due to the nature of Aaron Campbell's personality structure and his complex risk factor. I apologise to the court for appearing pessimistic. However, I am not confident that Aaron Campbell has the capacity or desire to change his behaviour in any meaningful way. And as such, the risk will remain for the foreseeable future. Aaron Campbell is serving one of the longest terms in detention ever imposed on a juvenile offender in Scotland. Wendy Davis, the head of the primary school, said that she was a happy, chappy youngster who would never be forgotten. A large wooden playhouse inspired the children to play and have memories of Alesha was decorated with pictures and unicorns and butterflies. The playhouse was built in the school grounds. It was a lasting tribute to the child with the infectious smile. Alicia's mum made a statement. Words can't express how devastated I am to have lost my beautiful, smiley, wee girl. I am glad the boy who did this has finally been brought to justice and that he will not be able to inflict the pain on another family like he did to mine. Alesha, I love you so much, my wee pal. I will miss you forever. We can't believe that we will never see our wee angel again. We hope the boy who took her from us is jailed for a long time for what he had done to our family. Alesha may be gone from our family, but she will always be in our hearts. Thank you so much for listening to today's episode. I hope to see you all again next week. Take care. Much love, Lindsay.